Sheol. Gehenna. Hell. Are real. And worse than you think. Hell is the unquenchable fire, the eternal destruction, the everlasting contempt, the unending torment, the bottomless pit where there is gnashing of teeth, and a place filled with maggots that will not die. Wake up. Hell is a place of total darkness, torment, and anguish, a place originally designed for Satan and his angels. However, due to the sinful nature of humanity, being cast through the gates of hell is not preserved just for the devil and his demons. Hell is now reserved for human beings too. Where are you going? Jesus, who talked about hell more than any other person in the Bible, went so far as to say it is better for you to cut off sinful parts of your body and enter heaven as a cripple than to go to hell in one piece. For everyone in hell will be salted with fire. This eternal punishment is kept for those who reject God, those who neglect the Holy Spirit, and for those who deny Christ. And on the day of judgment, your fate will be decided, not based on how good of a person you thought you were, but whether you had faith in Christ's death and resurrection, repented, and made him the Lord of your life. Brothers and sisters, I urge you to not let the fires of hell be your fate. Do not give up. Do not let the devil win. Do not give in to the temptations of this world, and do not succumb to the fleshly weaknesses. Focus. Focus on the mission at hand. Set your mind on things above and keep on fighting the good fight of faith towards Christ. You have one chance in life. Use it wisely. Because when you die, there are no second chances, and there is no going back. Luke 16, 23 through 26 says, "And in Hades, being in torment, he lifted up his eyes and saw Abraham far off and Lazarus at his side. And he called out, 'Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus to dip the end of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am in anguish in this flame.' But Abraham said, 'Child, remember that you in your lifetime received your good things, and Lazarus in like manner bad things. But now he is comforted here, and you are in anguish. And besides all this, between us and you, a great chasm has been fixed, in order that those who would pass from here to you may not be able, and none may cross from there to us.'" Hades, Sheol, Gehenna, Hell, and the Lake of Fire are all words used to describe a terrible place of punishment, but are separate in meaning. Hades and Sheol are both used to describe a place of the dead. Sheol in the original Hebrew is described as the realm of the dead, and Hades in the original Greek was illustrated as the grave and a place of torment when unbelievers die. Accordingly, Hades and Sheol are described synonymously in the Bible as a temporary place of punishment that occurs before final judgment, a place reserved for unrighteous souls who are awaiting to be thrown in the lake of fire. Gehenna, meaning Valley of Hinnom, was a physical valley outside of ancient Jerusalem. This place was used to dump criminal corpses, garbage, and also as a place of child sacrifice, a wretched sight. Jesus symbolically described hell as Gehenna, the place where the worm does not die, to portray hell's horrific attributes. Finally, the lake of fire is the final destination for those not found in the book of life, for Satan and his angels. Revelation 20, 11 and 14 through 15, "And the devil who had deceived them was thrown into the lake of fire and sulfur where the beast and the false prophet were, and they will be tormented day and night forever and ever. Then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. This is the second death, the lake of fire. And if anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire." The lake of fire is where torment lasts forever into eternity. There will be incessant weeping, gnashing of teeth, and indescribable pain. Ultimately, hell encompasses Hades, Sheol, Gehenna, and the Lake of Fire, which are all dreadful places, but each have their own meaning and purpose in describing God's judgment. Regardless of the title, we can be certain that hell is worse than we think. And above all, one thing remains clear. There are more people in hell than heaven. Matthew 7:13-14, enter by the narrow gate, for the gate is wide and the way is easy that leads to destruction, and those who enter by it are many. For the gate is narrow and the way is hard that leads to life, and those who find it are few. But remember, Christ has offered us a way to escape this fiery torment. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. Where are you going?
Some people like their pastors to have a fire and brimstone approach. I showed that video this morning. So you get the idea of hell. And as we're talking about the things we're talking about in Revelation, we have to remember that the ultimate, you know, judgment for the unbeliever is hell. That, you know, we can't just, as believers, we just can't say, okay, God is love and he does all these things. It's interesting. We had this discussion at Bible study last Monday night about some of the guys that stand on the boardwalk and will say, you're going to hell, right? And you get those people who argue. You can laugh, it's fine. But the discussion that happens is you get people who argue with them, okay? Because let's be honest, we live in a world today that doesn't want to be told that they have to deal with their sin, so they're offended quite easily, right? And so you get those arguments. And realize, we've got to be careful with that, because what we want to do is we want to show them that God's a God of compassion and mercy, but he's also a God of judgment, right? But if you just start about, if you just deal with the fact that they're going to hell and you want to state that, the problem is going to be is you're going to have people that are going to be turned off because they're never going to hear about God's mercy and grace, because all they're going to think about is judgment. And they don't want people, there's not a person here who wants to be judged, right? I mean, I said this is a Bible study. Anybody want to share their sins this morning?
No, thanks.
You sure? Nobody wants to stand up and go, guess what I've done, right? Right, because that's one of the things that you realize. Believers even don't want to do it, right? And we're given the gift of Jesus Christ, and that gift is so that we don't have to face judgment. But there's things that we know that we've done that we're embarrassed by, that we don't want other people to know about. And as you look at that, you have to realize that that judgment is there. And so that's, you know, I want to show that this morning, because we're going to talk about basically the angel that comes out of the bottomless pit and Abaddon or Apollyon, and we're going to talk about that some, and I just figured to give you a little insight in that would help. So I hope you guys had a happy Thanksgiving. Everybody have a good Thanksgiving?
Yes.
We had a good time here. We had, I guess, 15 people, and it was good, the turkey, and it looks like I'll probably do it each year from now on. I guess so. So as long as the Lord keeps me here, so... And maybe Jesus will come back. If he comes back, we don't have to worry about Thanksgiving again, right?
Right?
Amen?
Amen?
Amen. I hope he comes back. The best Thanksgiving would be Jesus showing up, right? So that said. So I'll go over some of the announcements. If you take a look at your bulletin on the third page of your bulletin, Bill is going to have a meeting after church for the pasta dinner. So anybody who's willing to help or wants information about it, they'll be meeting back in Fellowship Hall after church. Also, we do a Bible study. We're meeting tomorrow night. We're going through the book of James. We made it through one whole verse last week, I think. Hey, that's pretty good for us. Sometimes I don't even get a verse. We wind up going a different direction. But we had a nice discussion and talked about a lot of things last week. So the nursing home guest list is in the back. I think almost all the names are taken. They're all done. They're all taken. So good. That's fine. They're the 17th, right, for our birthday party for Jesus. All the presents are due back for that Sunday. Yes, they'll go under the tree, and then we'll pray over them, and then we'll take them during that week. So keep that in mind. And they really do appreciate them, so keep those people in prayers. You're buying those gifts and everything, pray for that person. They receive it, that, you know what, that God's moving in their heart and helping them, because they're not in the best of situations at the nursing home. So Let's see. Grief Share is still taking place. She meets on Tuesday, so if you have any questions, you can contact Laurie. The website is there. Our next Believers class, I don't know if that's going to work on the 17th if we're doing Birthday Party for Jesus. So birthday, that may, we may just move it to January, guys, for the, it's. I hate to call it New Believers class. It's not necessarily a New Believers class. It's really believers that want information about the church and are interested in the church, what we believe is a congregation or a church, and that various things. And then also to help you grow if you are a new believer in understanding what we're, what we are as a church. So, well, that'll be in January. Okay, we'll do that the third Sunday in January. And then, let's see, what's the other thing I wanted to mention? Offering envelopes. Barb wants to make sure you all know that offering envelopes are in the back, so if you need them, you have them. What are you going to say, Ian? Sign up for luncheon. And ladies, fellowship luncheon, sign up is in the back, so you can do that as well. And what other things? I know there was something else I wanted to mention, but that it can't be that important. I don't remember. So let's get up and pass the peace of God to one another this morning. So if you guys would get back to your seats, we're going to do the call to worship. I'll read non-bold, you read bold. I'll give you a chance to get back to your seats, though. So if you notice, I'm going to be standing closer to the pulpit because the one pole's in the way. And so I looked last night when we were setting them up, and if I stay close to the pulpit, then what happens is the camera angle can catch me. But so Dave said to me, because we may have to take it down before service is over. So that's it. But we're going to do the call to worship. I'll read non-bold, you read bold. Make a joyful noise, a noise of service and love.
Praise God with lives of compassion.
Sing with acts of kindness. Praise God with works of justice.
Praise God with overflowing love.
So we're going to sing this morning, Lord, I need you.
Sing, Lord, I come.
Lord, I come. I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. How I need you.
Where sin runs deep.
Where sin runs deep. Your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need. So teach my soul to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. righteousness. Oh God, how I need you.
Does anyone have a praise you want to share? I'll start with this. We did Thanksgiving dinner, and it was great to have everybody was here. My dad couldn't make it because he didn't feel good that day. But I talked to him a couple times since then, and he's doing a lot better. He said I gave him a ton of food, which I tried to make sure he had plenty. But we did. It was really good. Everything turned out well. Even the stuffing I made that people didn't think was going to be any good was very good. Yeah, I try not to say anything. I kept quiet over all these years, but I watched my mom cook a number of times. My mom was good with that stuff. So anyone else have a praise you want to share? Get Russ.
I just want to thank everybody.
Amen.
I've seen some light at the end of the
Amen. Yes. If you can tell, he's standing up straight. That's the first time in a long time I've seen him standing up straight. So praise God. That worked out well. So anybody, anything else?
Yep. Thank
yeah, Krista and I were going to take the last one, so.
But if you need to see it again, I'll have it back in here.
Yep. So, anybody, anything else? Yeah. I'll wait, Gina, I'll get you next. Yeah.
Joey has a point.
Yeah, Joe.
Well, I just want to thank everyone for the prayers for my friend. He's been a lot better.
Is he? Oh, that is a praise. It's good. So, okay. We'll still keep praying. You got it. So, get Gina. Yep.
And I also have a second one. I am volunteering at an animal shelter, and we have four dogs that need to be adopted. One of them has cancer. We are going to have her treated, but I just ask for all of your prayers for those dogs because they're wonderful, and I feel so blessed to be able to be a part of them. But just pray for them. Pray for the pups.
Yep.
You know me with my pups. Amen.
And I do want to praise that everybody showed up last night to be able to set up for this. So we got everything set up. Even though Advent doesn't start until next Sunday, okay, we got this done pretty fast. It was less than 2 hours. So, and it was a good thing because I forgot that I had a marriage counseling session after this. They showed up just, and they called me and said, we're on our way. We're almost there. I'm thinking, I thought it was today. I actually thought it was today. So I was like, okay, you sure? Like, yeah. I'm like, okay. So that worked out well. Yeah, it does. It worked out really good because I was sitting here, and they called them thinking, they're supposed to meet me tomorrow, not today. So, pretty good.
I met a woman the other night, Dawn, and I don't know her dad's name, but he's had a stroke, and he's pretty bad.
Okay.
I told her we would pray.
We can do that right now. So anybody, anything else? Okay. You can't hold on to the pole and raise your hand. You have to hold your hand up. Yeah. So get it. Okay. Well, you've got, like I told Ann, you've got 2 hours to remember. So here we go. We will pray right now for Dawn's father. Your heavenly father, Lord, we come before you in the precious name of your son, Jesus. Lord, we do. We lift up Dawn's father. Lord, you know exactly what's going on with him. And Lord, you are a great God, able to do all things. And Lord, we're coming together under the power of Jesus' name and asking for this, Lord, that you would just put your hand upon him. Lord, help him get through this time and be with her as well. And we thank you, Lord, that we can ask you these things and that you're so compassionate and so kind and so gentle and so loving that you can move upon any heart. And we just ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So, okay, Dave. Huh? You remember now? Now you're going to remember. Go ahead.
I was blessed with the church-delivered Thanksgiving dinner to make Thanksgiving.
So thankful. Okay. Amen. Okay. Yeah, Dave, you want to lead us in the next song?
Sing the next one once again.
Jesus Christ, I think upon your sacrifice. You became nothing, poured out to death. Many times I wondered at your gift of life, and I'm in that place once again. And I'm in that place once again.
And once again.
And once again I look upon the cross where you died. I'm humbled by your mercy and I'm broken inside. Once again I thank you, once again I pour out my life. Now you are exalted to the highest place, King of all heavens, where one day I'll bow. But for now, I marvel at your giving grace, and I'm full of praise once again. And I'm full of praise once again. And once again, I look upon the cross where you died. I'm humbled by your mercy and I'm broken inside. Once again, I thank you. Once again, I pour out my life. Sing that again, once again. And once again, I look upon the cross where you died. I'm humbled by your mercy and I'm broken inside. Once again, I thank you. Once again, I pour out my life. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for the cross, my friend. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for the cross, my friend. And once again, I look upon the cross where you died. I'm humbled by your mercy and I'm broken inside. Once again, I thank you. Once again, I pour out my life. And once again, I look upon the cross where you died. I'm humbled by your mercy and I'm broken inside. Once again, I thank you. Once again, I pour out my life.
So if I could have our ushers come forward. So while we're taking the offering, I just want to throw this out here. I want to try and start during service to add an addition to this, which is, would be a scripture reading, where if a church member wanted to come down and read, and I could pick the scripture, but I want to see if I can get volunteers. So what I'll do is I'll put a sign-up sheet up next week, and if you're interested in coming forward, it would be a couple verses, but just during the service where we have a point where you come down and read a scripture, a passage of scripture. It may relate to the sermon. It may relate to something else, but if you're interested in doing that, I'd like to have a group of people who'd be interested in doing it because it just adds a change up. Plus, I like the reading of God's word in church. I think it's important to have that. So if you're interested in doing that, we're going to add that to the service. So please, you know, let me know, okay? So if I can have our ushers come forward. If you would stand with me this morning, let's sing the doxology. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Amen. Thank you, guys. You can take your seats. So as we're going through Revelation, we've been looking at chapter 9, and this one is the O of Woe. So, and the reason I wanted to do the O of Woe is because we're getting into the, we're finishing the first woe this morning. And I think it's important that the Bible, when the Bible has the word woe in it, it means something substantial, especially in judgment, is going to happen. And when you see that, and you realize there's three in Revelation, and we're just looking at the first one, we've already seen that the first four trumpets, what we saw was natural things being affected. But then there's this spiritual thing that's taking place, and we started looking at it last week. We talked about these locusts that show up, right? And so, and we're going to talk more about it. And this week, as I was reading things and looking at things, there's so many various opinions on things here. Revelation chapter 9 is probably the most difficult chapter in all of the Bible. Okay? There's a number of things in there that no matter what you do, how you look at it, scholars are not 100% sure. Even when I was in seminary, we had a lot of discussions about this. And I think it's important as you sit here this morning that realize that what we're looking at here is definitely God's judgment. It's something extremely serious. There's definitely a spiritual component to this, a very serious spiritual component. See, we as Christians sometimes really just look at the physical and not the spiritual, but our Bible is very spiritual, and there's a lot of spiritual things in it, and we talk about demons and demonic things. We don't really have a grasp of those things. We see what goes on in the world, but we really don't have the grasp of what the demonic is really like. And as we look at this morning, and I'll do that with Revelation this morning, I'm going to pick up, you know, with verse 6 where we left off, and it says here, and I'm sorry, let me go back mine here so it matches what's on the screen here. So you see, in those days, people will seek death but will not be able to find it. They will long to die, but death will flee from them. And we talked about this last week. Imagine there is a point in time where you are, because we've seen it before in culture. We've seen, anybody remember Dr. Kevorkian? Yes. Okay, remember Dr. Kevorkian. What did he want? He wanted to be able to assisted suicide so the people could die whenever they wanted to die, right? Okay, and there's, we even have, when we talk about this, there's even a compassion that goes with allowing people to die. I don't know about that. I don't know if that's compassion all the time, because people want to live, right? And the idea in Canada, and even now in New Jersey, you can die with just the assistance of a person, okay? You realize in our state now that that's allowed to happen. And they're getting to the point now with babies that babies can be born, and up to 28 days after they're born in a couple states, if the mother doesn't want the baby anymore, that baby can be killed. Okay? And you go, well, that's not right, right? But it's part of the law. Maryland has it. California has it. And you go, well, how could people be so uncompassionate, right? But see, there's going to come a point where people are going to want to die because of what's taking place and the torment that's happening, and they won't be able to. Imagine going to the doctor and saying, give me something that'll kill me. And they'll go, guess what? They're going to bring you back to life anyway. So as you look at this and you see what's happening here, you go, man, this is a torment that's beyond anything we can imagine. And see, he goes on here and says, I want to share a couple things. I don't know if I said, verse 7, it says, now the locusts look like horses equipped with for battle. So we've got this idea that these things coming out of that pit, right, are similar to locusts. What's some of the characteristics of locusts? They live for 5 months. Did you know that? When they come together and they start to eat stuff, that usually takes 5 months. When you see a plague of locusts come through, that lasts for about 5 months. So you realize something interesting here, right? This thing, and he mentions locusts. So the nature of this is definitely similar to locusts. But then it says, when their heads were something like crowns, similar to gold, and their faces look like men's faces. So both of these things here, it looks like gold, right? And similar, like crowns. See, the words here in Greek, they're not exactly gold crowns, and they're not exactly like men's faces. But this is the best way to describe it. So you realize that John's seeing this, and there's something in his eyes that he's seeing this, and it resembles these things, so he says this is what it looks like. And it's interesting because I've had people over the years tell me that these could be aircraft, because even when I was in the Air Force and we flew, you know what they painted on the aircraft a lot of times? They made them look like what? They'd make them look like faces, right? But I think the thing that stands out to me here is you've got these faces and you've got these crowns. So these are something that are under authority of some kingdom, right? You realize that something's going on here, spiritual, that we really still don't understand. And the more that I read about this, and the more that I looked into it, the more I thought about it, and even when I was going through school, this is one of the things that always stood out to me is, what are they talking about here, and what is God trying to bring across to us? Because we went to this fifth trumpet, and this fifth trumpet is taking place, and we see these things sting, and the torment lasts for 5 months, which is similar to the plague of locusts when they last, right? So this unending sting, this gnaw, this thing that stings, lasts for 5 months, and now you see what they look like and realize that they have these images, and you're going to know exactly that there's something different, right? And it says their faces look like men's faces. So when you look at these things, now locusts, you ever see a locust? That's got a bug face, does it not? I mean, they had the big eyes, you know, the little things and all that stuff. That's how they look. But this thing you've got this thing, it has a man's face. And the interesting thing that came across me this morning was that I think that even in this, part of the transgender thing is mentioned here. And I'm going to show you why, because when I was looking at this, I'm thinking, well, wait a minute, similar to men's faces. And then verse 8 said they had hair like women's hair. Right? So you've got men's faces with women's hair. Why? Okay, I kept thinking, why is that there? But realize, in demonic, they're going to try and pervert everything, right? So, and our culture today, isn't it perverting everything? So you've got this man's face, right, with women's hair. Now, I don't understand that, because maybe what it means is men are more prone to be bald and women have long hair. But think about this. Maybe their hair is done up real nice, right? Maybe they're flying around with curlers on. Who knows, right? Right? So as you look at this, realize something. There's something that stands out to John, that he sees the men's faces, right? And then they've got crowns on, but women's hair. And their teeth were like lion's teeth. Okay? Now think about lion's teeth. What do lion's teeth? How many times have you seen lion's teeth? Right? When they roar, I remember we were in the zoo, okay? And one was sitting there, and it got hungry. And it just went, rawr. Because he was hungry. He didn't want to get up and move. He was just hungry. So he went, rawr. Right? And when you see their teeth, they're big little monsters. Yeah. So when you see this, realize something. This isn't like anything we've seen before, right? And I've talked about this. When this pit is open, when he opens this bottomless pit and these things arise out of it, there's something that you can feel that's spiritually different here, okay? That God's judgment now is hitting at a level that we haven't seen it hit it before. And so you get this, and I want you to see something here, that the more I looked at this and more guys tried to explain it, people were trying to explain it, the one thing that kept coming out to me was, you know what? Do you think it's going to be anything like we really think it's going to be like? Now, I just played the video about hell. And hell, people have all kinds of opinions of hell, do they not? I hear people say, well, I'd rather be first in hell than second in heaven. Okay? I've heard people say that numerous times. Where hell's going to be fun, heaven's going to be full of these people that all they're going to do is sit there and worship, right? And I look at this and go, you have no idea what heaven's about, but you really don't understand hell. If you talk about hell that way, you've got no understanding what hell's like, okay? Because these things are locked up in that pit, and guess where they're going to go back to? They're going to be in the lake of fire, in the pit. They're going to be where hell is, okay? And so you're going to get a taste of it. The earth, we're going to be with God. We know we're going to be with Christ, right? But the earth is going to experience this, and they're going to experience this, and they're still not going to turn away. They'd rather die than turn to Christ. Isn't that sad?
Yeah.
See, as you look at this, and you realize these things are going on, and when I researched this, I kept going, well, God, why is it that we can't just get an exact idea of what they are? But see, and then the next part of it, look what it says in verse 9. It says they had breastplates, like iron breastplates, okay? So, and even this is interesting because in the Greek again, it's not exactly, usually the word for breastplate is the word there, but it's like breastplate. It's kind of like the scales of a breastplate. So when you look at it, it says, and the sound of their wings were like the noise of many horse-drawn chariots charging in the battle. I think when John hears that, he has no idea how to put that sound in effect. But if you ever heard a jet engine, if you've ever heard one fire up and really get loud and be behind one, you have to have ear coverings. That's how loud it is. But can you imagine if these things are able to fly, right? They got faces like men, right? They've got hair like women. They're wearing a crown. They got teeth like lions. And now you hear these things, vroom, right? And they can fly probably at speeds that none of us will even be able to understand. But imagine a swarm of these things invading an area, right? Imagine, like, you know, when you see, you know, when we were in Africa and killer bees, okay? When we were there, and they would watch it, they'd say, watch out for a swarm of killer bees. When you'd see them, there'd be 2,000 to 3,000 of them that would come into an area at a time, okay? And you knew you wanted to get away from them, okay? You found a place, and you tried to get away from them. When you see this, you can't get away from them. And remember, they're like locusts in the fact that what's going to happen is when they sting you, how long does that sting last? 5 months. It's torture. It's endless torture for those 5 months. And so you've got this picture here. See, I keep going back to this, and I'm going to stress this. How in the world would you want anybody that you know to go through this? Right? Like, you know, as a believer in Jesus Christ, you're not going to go through this. You're going to be with Christ, right? But realize something. What if I'm wrong? What if I'm wrong and we're going to be here during judgment? What we do know is he protects those, right? Because we saw that the believers, 144,000, and anyone who's accepted Christ during this period of time, they have a mark, right? So the other thing is that you know that during this period of time, even if I'm wrong about the tribulation, okay? Even if I missed my doctrine and theology, I messed it all up. The one thing I know is that God's marked the believers. And the believers are going to be protected from this. The other thing is, understand who's in authority. Who's in authority here? Huh?
God is.
Ultimately, God is. See, even though these demonic things are coming upon the earth, who's still in charge? God, because God tells them that they're not allowed to kill, right? But they're allowed to torment. You got that? That God ultimately is in control. God is saying, look, you know what? No matter what happens, this is judgment, and I'm in control. That even Satan, even the demons, have to listen to who? God. See, and the world should see that, should they not? But what happens? What are they looking at? They're looking at themselves. See, they get caught up in themselves. Even today, isn't that part of the problem? We live in a world that when problems happen, my dad and I were talking about this, with all this stuff that's happening, guess who they want to blame? God, okay? But guess who they don't turn to? They don't see, isn't that sad? That when problems are happening, who do they want to blame? God, of course. But when things are going well, who do they ignore? See? And you've got this. Look, if this doesn't this sound kind of wacko? When you look at what's happening here, here are these creatures that come out of the pit. They're released, okay? And there's smoke, because we saw it earlier. There's smoke that enters with them. So there's this demonic smell presence that comes with them. And now they're all over the earth. They're flying around. We know that a third of the trees, a third of the plants, we know that grass is totally destroyed, right? We see all that earlier in chapter 9. We got that picture. But now we've got these things released, and you go, whoa. And you want to die, but you can't die. We also know already to this point in Revelation that a third of all the people on the earth are what? They're dead. Okay? So now you get to verse 10. They have tails and stingers like scorpion, and their ability to injure people for 5 months is in their tails. Okay? Again, all I can say is, look at some of the stuff that's been developed just recently. Even COVID. Now they realize that COVID was developed in a lab. Okay? All that stuff took place, and look at what happened, right? Look at the fear. Look, not even the danger of COVID, but the fear that spread. They made it so that you didn't get together Thanksgiving or Christmas. Okay? Isn't that great? And I don't care what anybody says. You can argue with me till Jesus comes back. But realize something. They scared the living daylights out of people, and they did not want people to be together. Okay? They did that on purpose. And the reason they did that is, realize something, is that you had loved ones you should have been around. We had funerals that people couldn't even come to. Isn't that sad? And you think that this is going to be something, like, it's going to be worse. Can you imagine these things flying around and the CDC going, you got to stay away from these things. Right? You need our latest vaccine. Right? Can you imagine the stuff they'll put out there? I mean, think about all the hype. Do you think they'll hype this? They will hype this to no end. See, realize something. You've already been brainwashed to believe that everything they're telling you is the truth, right? And God's saying, uh-uh, look, these things are going to happen as part of judgment. But see, part of it is that he says that once the spirit of deception comes into the world, it's going to grow worse. We do have a spirit of deception in the world, do we not? People don't want to accept Christ today. Nobody wants to accept Christ. They're saying, well, I'm okay the way I am. That's why the message of the gospel is so important. We talked about this Monday night. Look, when you talk about salvation, it's important. See, somebody needs to be saved. An important thing is the message of salvation goes to this. When you look at it, this, it's about Jesus Christ dying on the cross for what reason? For your sins. You got that. That each one of us is a sinner. Okay, and the reality is, if we don't accept Christ, there is a place to be with him if you accept him, but there's also a place to be if you're not with him. That's what the fire and brimstone at the start of the service was all about, right? But everybody wants to think, I'm okay, right? I've had people tell me before, well, you know what? Even atheists, right? They do some good things. Realize something, the Bible tells us that our hearts are deceitfully wicked, okay? No matter how much you try, you know what? Your heart is deceitfully wicked. And the only way, it only means of salvation is through Christ. There's no other answer. You can't say, well, what about Buddha? What about this? There's only one person who died on the cross for your sins. It's Christ. And the one Revelation's all about is Jesus Christ. So as you sit here this morning, realize something. The one who's bringing this judgment is who? Jesus. Because Jesus died on the cross. See, there's a reality to the cross that we don't even look at. There's judgment that comes after the cross. Because he's paid the price, and if you won't accept him, he'll give you exactly what you want, separation from him. Jesus will allow you to be separated from him for all eternity if you don't want to accept him. And these things that are happening here should wake people up, but they're not. And this spiritual thing that's going on here, this is something that, realize, imagine hurting for 5 months. And still not waking up to God. And you're going to have people around that God's marked that aren't going to be affected by this. Right? I mean, I just look back at COVID and all the things that they told us. Right? And now the injury rate with the vaccine and all the things that they're talking about, all the stuff they lied to us about. Imagine they won't lie to us more. Can you imagine these things that are out there? When these things show up, the stories that we'll hear? I'm going to show you guys this video this morning. There's some lights that were over the Dome of the Rock in Jerusalem. So they're talking about UFOs again in Israel. Okay? And I didn't want you to get into the whole conspiracy side of this. I just wanted to show you that now there's these signs that are happening in Jerusalem. And even the Jews are looking at these signs going, something's happening here. Okay? Something's happening. And now they're talking about, well, you know what? There's a secret society of aliens, and we're all a part of it. Okay, and that's why I didn't play the video, because I didn't want to get into all that. Okay, because that's, realize something. Satan comes as an angel of light to deceive. And all these things are deceptions, so that when these things start to happen, people will believe anything but God. And then you get to verse 11. Look at what verse 11 says. Verse 7, they will have a king over them, the angel of the beast, whose name in Hebrew is Abaddon or Apollyon. Okay? So there's an angel over these things. There's an order. He's king. You got that? He's the king of these. Realize, this is we're fighting, and the Bible tells us, we don't fight against flesh and blood. You got that? What do we fight against? Against spirits, powers of darkness, things in realms that we don't even understand. And realize something, these things are going to be released, and it's going to hit the earth. And see, when you look at the spiritual things that take place, and you see this king, this angel, Abaddon, and it's interesting because in researching this, some want to say it's Satan. I don't think it's Satan, because we see Satan earlier, okay? But what you see here is there's a king over this abyss, okay? There's a king, so there's hierarchy. In God's angels, there's hierarchy. In this, we see hierarchy. There's a king, so there's one that's going to rule. But this isn't the ultimate ruler, is it? Who's the ultimate ruler? Jesus is, right? Because they even answer to Jesus. They answer to Christ. See, they can't do anything unless God allows them to have that ability to do it. See, I want you to see that. Time and time again, ultimately, who's in charge? See, this is the part that we struggle with, because we don't like the idea that God has judgment, do we? We don't really like that. Like, when you're looking at this, do you feel comfortable about this? But you look at it and you realize that even the angel, this king, this one who's over all these locusts, okay? And there's so much I could tell you about this. Abaddon is referred to a lot of times in the Bible and the Old Testament as a place of death, okay? So you see this. And Apollyon, it's interesting because Apollo, you guys all know Apollo, right? A lot believe that John uses Apollyon here to make fun of Apollo, who was king of the locusts in Greek mythology. Okay? Isn't that interesting? So when you see this, you go, wow, you know what? God's making sure that even those who mock him and use his authority, because you talk about these Greek gods, right? That was all a mocking of God, was it not? And so even here, you got John saying, you know what? Apollyon, Abaddon. So you've got this place of death, the word here means destroyer. Both of those words mean destroyer. So what are they coming for? They can't kill, can they? What can they do? They can destroy your faith in anything. They'll destroy it. They'll just make a mess of things. Realize, we've got a third of the people dead. We've got a third of the plants dead. The grass is all dead, right? We know the sea, a third of that's a mess. Right, the ships are destroyed. The wildlife in the sea is dead. A third of it's dead. Right, so it's a great place to live. Right, boy, how many are going to want to have oceanfront property? Huh? Think about this for a second. Are you going to want to live here? I can imagine now the whole island going up for sale. Right, can you imagine all the non-believers here putting their property up for sale? If you got the mark of God on your forehead, say, well, I'll buy that one, and I'll buy that one, I'll buy that one. Now, I don't think you'll be worried about that. Okay? But then you get to verse 12. Verse 12 says, the first woe is past, right? So we got to the first oh and woe, right? Oh, man, this is it. This is the first one. All we've gotten to right now is the first woe. We've got two more to go, right? And we've got a couple chapters of woe still to do here, right? Think about this. When you look at this, he says, and there's two more woes that are still coming after these things. So you know that this is going to last for 5 months. You got that? 5 months of this. Because we know that the lifespan of a locust is what? 5 months, right? We know that when plague comes, it lasts for 5 months. So when this is happening, these are going to last. We see this, at least we got a time frame here. This is 5 months, right? And that's just one woe, right? We're not talking about the other four trumpets. Where this is the fifth trumpet, right, we saw here, and we've got this. Think about this for a second. Do you really want to have anybody that you care about experience this?
No.
See, what kind of people should we be then? Right? What kind of people should we be? Shouldn't we be loving and compassionate? Shouldn't we talk about what God's like? See, I think one of the cool things about doing Thanksgiving here was just the fact that, you know, we're always with our family, right? You know, and we share things with our family. But to be with other people and just be able to talk about what you're thankful for, right? Just to be thankful, you know? It's so great sometimes to just be with people and hear the nature of how they love God, how they're glad that they're together with a group of other people. You know, even Christmas. Think about it. We got Christmas coming, right? I mean, we're all decorated for Christmas. And Christmas is going to come. And then once Christmas is over, it's January and February. Oh, right? Oh. And my wife was born. My wife was born in February. So I always say, oh, man, they're the two worst months of the year. Okay? And I'm not picking on her, but they're cold. They're cold and miserable. The days are short. When you wake up, you don't go, wow, I'm so glad today's January. Right? Even if you're born in January, my aunt, who's my godmother, was born January 3rd, and I used to tease her all the time. I would say, Aunt Frieda, I said, you know what? January is the worst month. And she would go, oh, no. She goes, I was born in. I said, I love you, but it's still a bad month. Okay? Now, Krista always says, but February is the best month. Okay? And she's born the 27th, so it's, near the end of the month. But even January, isn't the first couple weeks of March, isn't even that a little bit? Yeah. And then what happens is He starts to kick over, and we get that wet fog that comes in. Yeah. In the end of March and April, and even in the first week or two of May, we get that. Like, we know what to expect. But realize something. When we're looking at these things, we have no idea of what we to expect here. We have some idea of what it may look like, but we really don't know what it's going to be like. And when you talk about, whoa, think about this. I don't know about you, but have you ever seen something go, whoa, right? This isn't like that kind of whoa. This is like, whoa, what's happening here? Okay? And then you get to verse 13, because here's a shift. Here's the sixth angel, okay? He blew his trumpet, and he heard a single voice coming from the horns on the golden altar that is before God. So realize something. This goes back to the tabernacle, and it goes back to the fact that even the temple, that they had this altar, okay? And the horn is a symbol of God and God's power and authority. So again, isn't it interesting that you've got these trumpets, but also you hear a voice coming from the horns? Whose voice would that be? Whose voice do you think it is? It's got to be Christ, right? Because remember, who's the one who's in charge? Right? So you've got this voice, okay, and this altar. And so out of those horns, okay, and realize those horns, a lot of times they would blow the horn, get ready for worship, or if they were going into battle, okay? So realize if he's saying something here, guess what? Something bad's going to happen here. And so you've got this sixth trumpet, right? We made it. We're six trumpets in. We're one woe in. We're in chapter 9 of Revelation. And we're barely halfway done. We're not even halfway yet. So think about this picture here, okay? And it says here, I'll finish with verse 14 today. It says, and saying to the sixth angel, the one holding the trumpet, set free the four angels who are bound at the great river Euphrates. Now realize something. You've got this picture here. Now you've got the four angels of the Euphrates. And I'm going to tell you that these aren't good angels. These are probably demons. And the reason why is because angels are usually free to roam because they're doing God's work. Okay? These are bound. And they're set free at this point. So realize, as we go forward, this is not necessarily a good thing, is it? Okay? So we've heard the sixth trumpet. We've got these four angels. And they're bound to the great river of Euphrates. A lot of people want to talk about various wars and various things are going to happen. And we'll get into that next week. But I want you to see something here. This is not a good setup for what's happening next. So we've got these flying locusts. Creature things all over the place. And nobody knows what size they are, right? We don't know how big they are. We're not told how big they are. Because when you say they have a face of a man, right? They could be big, right? We're not talking. Huh? Well, yeah, it talks about the size of a horse. So we've got these big things. But even then, what size type of horse? Okay, and remember, he's seeing them from a distance. So he's trying to use, see, the interesting thing, and it's great you brought that up, Scott. The interesting thing is, when he's looking at these things, right, he's seeing this vision that God's giving him, and he's trying to assign what he sees to what he knows, right? He doesn't know about what tanks look like, and he doesn't know what airplanes look like. He doesn't have any knowledge of that, right? So he's looking at these things, and he's trying to assign what he understands, what he sees, to what he sees here. So he gives it the size of a horse, right? So you look at it and go, that could be big. But it could be even bigger because horse might be the biggest animal he can think of to assign it to, okay? So you look at it. And remember, he's a distance. So he's seeing this from a distance. So they could be even bigger than what it is. So, and if you can make out the face, they got to be fairly large, right? And they got this stinger, right? They got this stinger. And just think about what that's like. Is that, I don't know about you, but when a bee lands on you and the stinger gets stuck in there, right? You got to pull that little bugger out. But imagine the size of these things, right? So as we move on, and we're going to talk about this, just remember, you've got that situation going on, and now you've got this next trumpet, and that woe is that woe is coming to an end. You've got this next trumpet, which starts the next woe, and here it is. You've got the four angels positioned at the river Euphrates, and we know what's close by. What's close by? Jerusalem and Israel, right? And so what's happening is, you see, this is all going to happen in that area. In Israel and Jerusalem, when you look at what's going on, happening over there, we have to realize something. There is a battle that's going to take place over there, okay? And the spiritual warfare that's taking place over there right now is just the beginning of what's going to happen. The door that's going to be open, the things we're going to see are nothing like we see now. It's going to be a lot worse. So as we're moving through Revelation, we're just getting a taste, okay? What we're seeing right now today is just a small glimpse of where it's headed, okay? And don't be careful. Don't buy into too many signs and say, I see this and I see this, and so this is going to happen. Because remember that no one knows the day and no one knows the hour. You got that? So don't let anybody tell you, well, it's happening today. Okay? You'll know, because once these signs start to happen, you'll know. Somebody doesn't have to predict it. When you see these things, look, when you see these things flying through the air, if you're still here, right? What are you going to do? You're going to go, I need a big fly swatter, right? If you see these creatures flying through the air, what are you going to do?
Run.
You're going to go, oh, man, but you can't even hide from them. People want to die. Imagine people saying to you, do you have some way that I can die? Run me over. You know, shoot me. And they take you to the hospital and go, guess what? We revived them. They're still alive, right? Isn't that great? Can you imagine that? Can you imagine there being a point where you want to die and they rush you to the hospital and go, we got him, he's still alive. And you're like, you're laying in bed, oh, I got stung and it hurts like anything. And they keep me alive, right? I can't imagine what kind of incredible torment that's going to be, right? Think about it. You want to die, you can't die. See, and when we get to this, and we'll talk about this more next week, I just want you to get the picture here that God is the one who's allowing this to take place, because people will not trust in Christ. You got that? So whoever wants to argue with you that there's millions of ways to be saved, there's different ways to be saved, realize something. The book of Revelation makes it clear. There's only one way. It's who? Jesus, okay? Do not think there's another way. This is it, okay? And there is no other. I mean, I've read the Quran. I've read all kinds of different religious things, taught courses on different things. I can tell you one thing. This is something that you only see with Christ, okay? You see his salvation. You see his grace. But you also see that there's judgment coming, okay? Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, what a great and awesome God you are. We thank you for the power of your word, who you are. Lord, the fact that we can spend time in your word and get to see and know you better. But, Lord, we also pray that we would be people who have a heart for you, that, Lord, will share Christ with other people, that, Lord, we will not go out of here without knowing that Jesus Christ is real, that he's alive, that he did this for us, and that, Lord, today's the day of salvation. And Lord, I pray that we would have this time during this holiday season to share it with loved ones, to share it with people that we come in contact with, that, Lord, we would not want one single person to go through this. And, Lord, we ask that you would do these things and do it in power. We thank you, Lord, that you are the God that you are, and we ask all these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen. So Dave is going to lead us in our final song this morning. We're going to thank you, Lord. If anybody has need for prayer, you're more than welcome to come forward. I'll anoint you with oil and pray over you while we're singing our last song.
Let's all stand up and we'll sing thank you, Lord. I come before you. I come before you today, and there's just one thing that I want to say. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for all you've given to me, for all the blessings that I cannot see. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. With a grateful heart, with a song of praise, with an outstretched arm, I will bless your name and thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you,
you've done in my life. You took my darkness and gave me your light. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You took my sin and my shame. You took my sickness and healed all my pain. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. With a grateful heart, with a song of praise, with an outstretched arm, I will bless your name and thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. With a grateful heart, with a song of praise, with an outstretched arm, I will bless your name and thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. And thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord.
Yeehaw! Okay, there you go. So, this morning, before you leave, okay, do me a favor. Please, just give somebody a hug and tell them that you were so happy they were here this morning. So we're going to close in prayer. May you have a great week. Dear Heavenly Father, we give you praise. We give you honor. We give you glory. We thank you for this day, Lord. We ask that we would just give you all the honor, all the glory, and that, Lord, we thank you for the ability to be able to have the words to be able to say thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Guys, have a great, great week. God bless you guys.